Bam, Mr. True. In this video, we're going to introduce the second fundamental theorem of calculus. Yes, there is two. If f is continuous on an open interval I containing a, then for every x in the interval, the derivative with respect to x of the definite integral of f of t dt from a to x is equal to f of x. So let's see here. It seems like if we have a definite integral whose lower bound is a constant and whose upper bound is the variable x, so it's not a constant like most of the time when we do definite integrals, it's just that variable x, we can see here there's a lowercase f and a lowercase f. So it looks like we can just take t out and plug in x and get our answer. And what we're going to do to show that this actually works is use three of our four examples from our previous video, definite integrals as a function. And why did we get definite integrals that were a function? It's because we did definite integrals that had an upper bound or an upper and lower bound, which were not just simple constants. They were algebraic expressions. And through that process, we got an antiderivative, or capital F, in terms of x. So we should be able to take the derivative with respect to x of those examples or those answers that we got from those examples in the previous video and see that the derivative of those f of x's, those capital F of x's, those antiderivatives, is equal to f of x. And so we can kind of cut out this middle work here of doing the definite integral and then finding the derivative, because we can see, we could just take out the t and plug in x. Well, let's see if that actually works. And of course it's going to. On a previous video, we talked about finding the definite integral of 10 over the square root of t dt from 4 to x. And when we did that, we got f of x is equal to 20 square root of x minus 40. Now again, notice we're going to a capital F, so it's the antiderivative in terms of x. Okay, so we should be able to, let's see here, f prime of x, the derivative of f of x, is equal to the derivative with respect to x of 20 square root of x minus 40. Now let's not forget, this is x to the 1/2 power. So taking the derivative of 20 square root of x is going to give us 20. We're going to take that power of 1/2 and bring it down, and then reduce it by 1. And then, of course, minus 40 is a constant, so the derivative of a constant is always equal to 0. Well, 1/2 of 20 is equal to 10. And x to the 1/2 power, that's the same as 1 over x to the 1/2 power. So that's, it's going to be 1 over the square root of x. So it's going to be 10 times, let's just say 1 over the square root of x just to show our work, and then it's 10 over square root of x. So you see what we have here? 10 over square root of x, which in that same pattern, 10 over square root of t, is the function, the way the function was written in our definite integral. We're just taking t out and replacing it with x. So the derivative with respect to x of the definite integral from 4 to x of 10 over square root of t dt is equal to 10 over square root of x. So it is the same function, just with t taken out and x replaced, put in its place. So here we have f of x is equal to negative cotangent of x plus 1, so f, the derivative of f of x is equal to the derivative with respect to x of negative cotangent x plus 1. Well, the derivative of the cotangent of x is equal to negative cosecant squared of x. And again, we have a constant here of 1, so its derivative is going to be equal to 0. And the negative that's in front of cotangent, along with the negative that comes in from doing the derivative of the cotangent of x, are going to cancel out, and we end up with just cosecant squared x. So again, because our lower bound is a constant and our upper bound is just a basic variable of x, we can take this expression that's in our definite integral and just say that f of x is the same. Just take out the t and replace it with x, and we get cosecant squared of x. Now, things get a little bit trickier when your lower bound is not a constant and your upper bound is not just a little basic x. So let's look at our last example and see how we're going to deal with those extra difficulties. In our last example, the use of the second fundamental theorem of calculus is not going to be as straightforward as the previous two examples. Why? Because our definite integral does not have a lower bound, which is a constant, nor is the upper bound just a basic variable of x. So we learned in our previous video, definite integrals as a function, that this definite integral of 3t squared minus 1dt from x to x plus 3 is equal to capital F of x, that antiderivative in terms of x, is equal to 9x squared plus 27x plus 24. Okay, so that means that the derivative with respect to x of this definite integral is equal to, let's see here, f prime of x, or the derivative with respect to x of this expression here is going to be, bring down the 2, 9 times 2 is 18x, and the 27x just simply becomes 27. So we can see that we're not just taking t out and replacing it with x. There's a lot more going on. So I'm going to step off and reveal the solution to this problem. And it's going to deal with actually a couple of properties we've learned with learned in the past to get this done. Let's not talk, let's just see that example. Okay, so I've written up the solution. Let's figure out what the heck we did. We had to use two properties of definite integrals, the additive integral property and this property here where I'm switching the upper and lower boundary of our definite integral, which is going to give us an opposite answer, and then finally finished off with the chain rule. So let's talk about it. For the second fundamental theorem of calculus to work, our lower bound must be a constant. Well, my upper bound is x plus 3 of my definite integral, my lower bound is x, I have no constant, so I need to introduce that. And for convenience sake, we're going to introduce the constant of 0. Okay, well, here I've got a definite integral going from x to 0, and I need that constant to be my lower bound, not my upper bound. And by the way, I've split this one integral, definite integral, into two, and the property that allows me to do that is the additive integral property. If you have a trouble thinking that 0, which I've introduced, I've kind of gone from x to 0 and then from 0 to x plus 3, and this would act as my variable c in that property of the additive integral property. Well, we talked about that extra break that we're putting in, this value of c does not need to be in between a and b for the additive integral property to work. So if it turns out that 0 is not between x and x plus 3, it's okay, it'll still work out. Okay, so I need that lower bound to be constant, so I'm going to take the lower bound here and the upper bound of my definite integral and swap them. And by doing that, I'm going to get the opposite answer from my definite integral. That's why this negative is here. That's another property of those definite integrals. And I have in my second term here, I have a lower bound that's a constant, but my upper bound is an expression, an algebraic expression of x plus 3. Well, I need that to be a basic variable of x, if you remember, from that property, or that second fundamental theorem of calculus. So I'm going to do a U-substitution and let U equal to be equal to x plus 3, and that's going to allow me to rewrite this definite integral with that basic variable x, or in this case u, as my upper boundary. Well, that means that I need to switch from d, the derivative with respect to x, to the derivative with respect to u, and go through that chain rule. And the derivative of f of x, or f prime of x, is equal to df over du, and we're going to work through that variable of u to ultimately get to that next step of multiplying by du over dx, that chain rule. Okay, so constant x, just take out the t and plug in x when we work out that derivative with respect to x of that definite integral. Well, here we have the derivative with respect to u. Here's an upper boundary of u, so we're just going to take that t out and plug in u, which we have here. But we also now need to include that du over dx part that we have at the second part of our chain rule. Well, now that substitution allows us to directly apply the second fundamental theorem of calculus, we need to get u and plug that back in. So u comes out, x plus 3 goes back in its place, but to take care of that du over dx, plugging back in that x plus 3, we get derivative with respect to x, and that du comes out, and I'm putting the substitution back in of x plus 3. Well, I've kind of made my example a little bit easier by letting my upper boundary of my original definite integral be a single degree or have a degree of 1. So when we take the derivative with respect to x of x plus 3, it doesn't come out to be a value of 1. That's where this is coming from. The derivative of x with respect to x is equal to 1. This is not always going to happen. If my upper bound happened to be, say, x squared, then this would be a 2x here. At this point, so just be aware of that. At this point, we're just going to finish simplifying all of this up, and we get 18x plus 27x. Now again, when we did definite integrals as a function, we saw that we got f of x was equal to, what was that again? Let's see. 9x squared plus 27x plus 24. That's what f of x was, and we took the derivative of that. We, of course, got the 18x plus 27 that we were hoping to arrive at. So we could have gotten the same answer, f prime of x, by not going through the second fundamental theorem of calculus. However, if you need to use the second fundamental theorem of calculus, this is, again, what it looks like, and this is the end of our last example. So, I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.